Hello, I'm Lisa.
I'm Cryss.
And welcome to the Three of Skeins podcast, episode number 56.
Did you need the fingers?
Yes, I did. Help keep everything in perspective, because you know my fingers don't always match.
Let's not talk about it.
Okay. So how are you doing today, Cryss?
Yeah. I feel like I was just supposed to say, oh, I'm great. But the truth is.
Real? Yeah, keep it real. You know, that's what we always do here. We keep it real. You working on anything good?
Well, technically. Oh. I took a week off from crocheting, sort of. I took a week off from stitching, but I found that I was still thinking about crochet like a whole lot. So I don't know how restful my week was. But I haven't made anything technically. I haven't like started a project, unless you count swatching, because I wanted to swatch before the break started.
So did you swatch before the break started, or did you swatch during the break?
No, I was supposed to start the break last week, the day we filmed, but I swatched that day instead. So technically my break started the next day. That's what I decided. I just shifted the break a little bit.
You know what? I'm not mad about that.
So technically, I'm not supposed to crochet again until tomorrow, but we'll see.
Well,
although I did a little work yesterday, but I didn't do any stitches. I don't know how we're counting that.
Secrets come out. Oh yeah.
But I didn't have a hook in my hand, so I don't think it counts.
So what kind of work were you doing?
So my shrug. She's getting a little work done on her. I put her in the body shop.
All right. Shall I put the picture up of at least the back?
Yeah.
All right.
So here was a problem. So you see how long it is? I couldn't figure out how to fold it and preserve length. Fold it into shrug shape and preserve length. So I decided I would go with length. And so I did kind of like a little janky thing at the bottom. We're not going to talk about, but I decided that I really hated that janky thing at the bottom.
Okay.
So you know how she had the collar and everything? I took her back to a rectangle.
Oh.
I took off the collar. I unstitched the sleeves.
Wow.
Undid the bottom and actually took off that seventh row of squares that I had added. So now she's back to 6x6. And I'm just going to fold her a different way. So it will be shorter when it's done. You're only going to see like four squares vertically when it's done, but I just like it better. It just looks way less janky. So I have to stitch up her sleeves again and do another, you know, collar thingy, but I didn't do any of the stitching. I did unstitching, so I don't know if that counts as breaking my break.
You know what, since you designed the break, even if you do a little something during the break, I think it's still okay. But I think that's an interesting point, that when you finish something, it may not actually be finished.
Because
I found that with several of my makes too, that once I wore it, then I could really see what it was going to be like.
She has a name though now.
Oh, what's her name?
So in light of her resemblance to a blanket, I have named her the Linus coat.
Oh, I like that.
Because, you know, if you are a Peanuts aficionado, you know that Linus always carried around a security blanket. So when I'm wearing this, I will effectively be wearing a small blanket. So she is the Linus coat.
Well, I think that's a really useful thing that a lot of makers don't talk about, that sometimes you think you're done, but the wear test is really the real reveal of whether or not you're done.
But I will show it again when it's all finished and then reworked. But
I didn't know any of that had gone down.
I know.
Wow.
I was upstairs very quiet. I was watching Daniel Spellbound and ripping her out.
How are you liking that?
It's cute. It's on Netflix. It's about this guy who doesn't do magic himself, but he is part of the magical world and he is on a mission. And it's just a cute little cartoon show. It's something parents can watch with kids, I imagine. I'm saying this as someone that doesn't have children, but because it's got just enough to keep an adult entertained, but it's very age appropriate for children. So if you get roped into watching TV with the kids, I would check out Daniel Spellbound. Yeah, that was just one of the things that went on during my break.
Wow. I didn't take a break because my brain has been itching with projects. So my intention last week, you know, things have changed. My intention last week was to actually get started on that. And I did. Ah, here's my swatch. So I picked this yarn because I have always loved it. And I thought it would make a good, you know, version of this thing right
and
here.
And you have a lot of it.
And I have scads of it, so I know I have enough. Okay, so.
I tell the people the truth.
Well, you see what happened was, so I started swatching, right? And I went through a whole swatching process where I tried a bunch of different stitch patterns. And this was the one I landed on. What I liked about this stitch pattern was that it has that horizontal line that I could see in the actual piece, but it wasn't a hard horizontal line. It's just like a little indication of things that might be happening. So this is called the Andalusian stitch. It's an old stitch pattern. What I liked about it though was it gave me the opportunity to try knitting backwards. So because there's two rows of all purl, and when I was planning to do that cape, it would be very long rows, and I was like, yeah, I'm not really here for that. So I did my swatch with the knitting backwards technique on the purl rows.
I thought you didn't mind purling.
I don't mind purling. But that's a couple of long rows of purling hundreds of times. So I was like, you know, and I was looking for an excuse to try this technique anyway.
When I tried to learn knitting, I quit when I got to purling.
I still take responsibility for that. I introduced purling too soon. But you should have seen her first knitting, okay? It was so nice and even. I was like, oh my God, she's going to take like this to it, like a duck takes the water. And I was like, all right, great, you got that. Let's purl. Nah, we lost one that day.
You see, purling isn't from knitting, and it's not enjoyable because you don't want to do long purl rows.
It's not that it's not enjoyable, but like most knitters who knit English or continental style, I do enjoy the knit stitch more. But also, doing this technique. Anyway, Marlon and Crystal were like, I think that yarn looks too heavy. But you know when you get obsessed? Mm. I was obsessed. I was like, I had finally found the project for this yarn. I was going to make it happen. So I don't even want to tell you how many swatches I did.
So many. I got a little stack of them.
I don't want to tell you how many they were. I tried different stitches. I tried different needles. I had gone all the way from 5 millimeter needle to a 7 millimeter needle.
But you all see the shawl she's trying to make and how light and diaphanous it is. And she's trying to recreate that with worsted weight yarn. And I was just like, I don't think that's a thing.
Yeah, they were right. All right. They were correct. And when I did my big swatch, I was like, still trying to convince myself, but I couldn't sell myself on it anymore. So I was like, okay. I'm going to find some other yarn for that project. I still have that project in my will do queue, not my, oh, wouldn't that be nice queue? But this yarn is not the yarn for it. But as I was swatching this yarn many times, I was still in love with it. I was like, I still want to use this yarn. And I discovered something with that technique of knitting backwards. Now, my gauge, I tend to be a loose knitter. That's something I know about myself. It's just how it is. So when I do, and there's a big difference between my knit gauge and my purl gauge. So when I do stockinette, you see like little lines in my stockinette because there's a gauge difference. Well, it turns out when I knit backwards, my gauge is much tighter on the purl side. Do you notice how this swatch that is a stockinette-based swatch is barely curling at all? It turns out between the loose gauge on the front of the swatch and the tight gauge on the back, it sort of balances the fabric. So I was like, ooh, bonus. So do give that technique a try. There's a bunch of videos about how to do it here on YouTube already. You don't have to turn the work, and it changes. It's going to change your gauge. So if you do decide to do that, don't start in the middle of a project. Things will go awry for you. So let me show you what I decided to go with instead. You see what happened was Mom had fallen in love with this book called Knit Kimono ages ago. And she has decided to make something out of this book. It is Knit Kimono 18 Designs with Simple Shapes by Vicky Square. And they are very, I would say, traditionally kimono-ish. So they're put together in the same sorts of ways. Some of the pieces are actually long to the ankle and all of that. There is a jacket in here called Dofuku that I was like, wait a minute, I like that. And as I was helping her with her project getting started, I kept going back to that page in the book. And then I started seeing it in my beautiful yarn with the stitch pattern.
Take the picture off.
I just want to see them together.
Look at that. Look at that.
Thank you. Everything is a reverse. Sorry about that. And when I saw those two together, it was Trask Radio for me. I was like, yes, these two will work. And I happened to look in the book.
You can tell us in the comments if you get that reference.
Yes. You know about Trask Radio. Let us know. When I happened to look in the book to see what kind of yarn they suggested, voila, it was worsted weight. And I was like, this is worsted weight. Let's do it. So I couldn't do anything but get started on the bad boy. This is the back. And I just love it. I absolutely love it.
So that you changed from the stitch pattern they're using in the book.
Yeah.
And they use your Andalusian stitch.
I'm going to use my Andalusian stitch instead. So mine is going to have texture. That's the one thing I did not like about it in the book. They did it with stockinette. And I thought it made it look a little bit plain. Mm-hmm. So if you notice, it had these contrast color lines. So for my contrast color, I'm going to go with this hot pink color. So I have this warm cream.
Not sure about those.
I like them together.
You should do a nice brown.
I think brown would be nice, but I just wanted a little pop of color. And since it's literally one row of knitting for the color, I thought I would get that pop from this pink. And when I took the picture of them, because I learned the lesson.
You could always do just really big squares.
Of course. I took a picture of the two yarns together, and that's what you want to see. You want to see light and dark, you know, clear contrast.
I'm going to be all orthodox about it.
You know, I'm not like a total, you know, orthodox person.
I mean, that's one way to do it.
If you want contrast, that is. If you want contrast, that's what you want to see when you put it in black and white. Just saying. I'm not saying. I'm just saying.
Mm-hmm.
So that's actually what I'm working on now. And I am working in, I don't know what the brand is exactly. It's RY. Can you see anything on there that might indicate anything?
Is RY the brand or is Classic Yarns the brand?
Girl, I don't know.
This was deep stash.
Yeah, this came out of my stash, and I've had this yarn for years. The only thing I can tell you is I probably got it at a sale from Smiley's. And if you see a sale from Smiley's, definitely go. because it is a 54% extra fine merino wool with 10% angora and 24% nylon. It's, I don't know, just velvety and delicious. And I got two bags of it, so I can tell you almost with complete surety, I didn't pay more than $25 a bag for it. And each bag had 10 balls in it. And these are 50 gram balls, but they go quite a good way. Anyway, and my hot
pink. When you started so far, how many balls is that?
That is, I just tied on the second ball. Yeah. I should probably show her the end. Oh, here it is. So all of this down here was one ball. And then I just started the second ball here. And good old ultra wool for my contrast color. Yeah, I just wanted it to have a pop of color rather than being. I know brown would look lovely. It would be very refined looking, but I just wanted something more fun.
What are you going to wear it with if you do pink?
Anything. I actually have quite a lot of pink in my wardrobe. I'd wear it with blue jeans. I think it would just be fun.
Okay.
Now, you know, I'm already considering changing up the lines a little bit, right?
Oh, goodness.
I'm just wondering if I want to put a row of hot pink along the outside edge. That's all. I'm going to do some sketches and see what it looks like.
Ooh, sketches.
I don't know why she thinks my sketches are so funny.
No, they're just entertaining.
Why come?
I don't know. It's just that they have a quality.
Oh, Lord.
A je ne sais quoi.
A je ne sais quoi. Well, you know, I've always wanted to have a je ne sais quoi.
Or a je ne sais quality.
Ooh, la la. Anyway, that's what I'm working on this week. What's going on with you? Because I know you're on a break, but kind of ish.
Mostly. I'm mostly broken.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly. So I was talking about making this top from a video. I saw a YouTube video how to. And my plan is to make each half of the top a different color. So I wasn't sure if my 100 gram skein was going to be enough to do a full half of the top.
Mm-hmm.
So I did some swatching. So I think this is the stitch pattern I'm going to use. Oh, I don't have a stitch marker in there. Interesting. So it's just three rows of single and then one row of trebles. And it's just a stitch pattern that I really, really like.
Yeah.
And I used my swatch to do some mathifying and to try to figure out ahead of time how much yarn I thought it would take to do half of the top. And the method that I used, I actually got from the book 6,000 plus sweater possibilities, 6,000 plus pullover possibilities, I think it's called, by Melissa Liebman. She describes a way to estimate how much yarn you will need for a project. And so that's what I did. And my estimate says that half of my sweater will take about 92 grams. However, that did not include, when I did the math, I was not including my sleeve cuffs mm-hmm. or my waistband. And so with those included, now it gets a little tight. So what I've decided to do, so my two halves of my top are going to be these two, which are from 100 Ravens.
Very pretty.
What I'm going to do is just throw in a little bit of a third yarn. So see them all together.
Mm-hmm.
I will either do one of two things. I will do my cuffs, my waistband, and then maybe like an inch of my neckline out of this, just to spare myself some of the yarn. Or I might just do the sleeves altogether. Yeah, you can.
Yeah.
She's trying to close the window because there's noise outside, but there's just going to be a little noise.
Sorry about that, guys.
Like, don't get obsessed. But what I'm also thinking is that I could just do my full sleeve out of this and then just do the body.
I like that.
So that it's almost like a raglan kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I think that'll be cute. And I won't run into any issues with running out of yarn, because these two skeins, that's what I got. Mm-hmm. And I don't, because I bought them a few years ago, and I don't know if they even sell this base anymore. It's called the Yaksha base, because it has, I think, 10% yak in it.
Yeah.
And I just saw 100 Ravens at New Jersey Sheep and Wool, and they did not have the space in their booth. So this is it. So I'm just going to figure out a way to employ a third yarn to keep the design, you know, to have the design make sense, but just lessen the demand on these two skeins. Okay. And I think it'll work out fine.
Yeah, and I think it'll be beautiful, especially with your mohair sleeves.
So
fancy.
That's what I'm going to be doing, I think. I'm pretty sure that's my next project. Pretty sure.
What's clawing at your mind?
The other one I showed y'all.
Oh.
We need to talk about this.
Okay.
So this top, I think it's called Jabot, and it is by Nora Gawn, and it's in a book called Knit, Fold, Pleat, Repeat. I always have to think about that before I can say it. Mm-hmm. But this is just like a little... on Ravelry, it's described as a poncho. In the book, she calls it a capelet. You go either way, because the sides are not seamed.
Oh.
So it's only seamed at the shoulders. And this thing is living in my head rent-free. So I actually bought the book that's in, because I was looking at the patterns on Ravelry, and I saw a lot of things that I liked. So I was like, well, let me go ahead and get the book. I didn't even realize this book just came out this year. So this is a new book. In Oregon, is she still currently the editor of Vogue Knitting? She's like editor emeritus.
Something like that. I don't know.
Yeah. So, Knit, Fold, Pleat, Repeat. This is the first knitting book I've ever purchased as a crocheter. Like, I spent money on a knitting book. But the whole idea behind the book is that you make very simple shapes, squares and rectangles and triangles, and then you do trickery, fakery, pokery to turn it into something else.
Right.
And that appeals to me because that's how I like to work. And I'm not the biggest fan of shaping, as important as shaping is. It's just more math that I have to figure out. And so if I can keep something a very basic shape, that is what I prefer to do. So this is like right in my wheelhouse. And I'm really glad I got the book because I feel like I've already learned just from like perusing it. I've already learned a lot from it in terms of ways to manipulate fabric and how to get. This really introduced for me the idea of draping,
yeah,
and crochet. So she, well, for her knitting, but for me in crochet. And she actually says in the book that she tries out her designs first on paper, like folding the paper, and then with just plain fabric. She'll buy knit fabric and practice her draping with that so she can see what she needs to mimic with her knitting. And I was like, that's a really good idea.
Hello.
So I think I might be doing that in the future. But there's some stuff in here that I just know that I can do versions of. And I'm just really excited about these the ideas that this book has given me. So there may be some things that I try like actually kind of closely approximating as I make. But there's also some things that I've just, it's given me ideas and I think I can do my own like kind of version of things.
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, it's just got me thinking about draping the fabrics that I create. And I'm really glad I got this book. And let me tell y'all, I have nothing against buying patterns online, getting patterns from Ravelry, or like I used to get a lot of patterns from redheart.com, and those mm-hmm. same patterns now, they're under the same company as Karen and Burnett. So
yeah.
Now, if you go to Yarnspirations, you'll find all the patterns that used to be on redheart.com. But those are free patterns, and they were well-written, so they were good beginner patterns.
Mm-hmm.
I had no problem with buying digital patterns. However, buying a book will always be the most economical way to get patterns, because there's got to be 20-odd, maybe 30 patterns in this book. And it was like $23,
$24.
Yeah, so I'm paying less than a dollar per pattern. So if you worried about the price of patterns, do not forget about published books, because you will get a lot of bang for your buck. The prices will usually come down to somewhere between $1 and $2 per pattern. And I'm always surprised that, you know, people seem to favor, you know, and I guess because Ravelry offers a database, and so you can search for the things that you really want. But what I love is using Ravelry to see all the patterns in a book, because if you're looking at a bookstore, if you're looking online at a bookstore, you don't know what's in there. Basically, you see maybe the front and the back cover.
Right.
So I love using Ravelry just to see what's in the book, so I know if there's enough in there that makes it worthwhile for me to spend my money. But then I will, you know, if I see enough patterns that I like, I'll buy the book. And I feel like I got really, really good value out of this, because this is going to help me with so many projects. So, and Mom and Lisa are already jumping on my book too.
Yeah, I was like, let me see that. There was like a little cue.
Yes, there really was.
Like, okay.
If I left it unattended, when I came back, it was someone else's hand.
You're done with that? I agree with you though about books, because if, let's say you make, you know, two things out of the book, like literal, you know, okay, I use this pattern, but I find that once I'm done with a book, or once I've used the book for a little bit, I transfer things that I got out of one book that I might apply to another pattern. So I'm still, you know, getting value out of that book.
And what one of the features of this book that I really like, for each pattern, she has a page where she, it says at the top of the page, design your own. And she tells you, like, her thought process, how the pattern developed for her, and maybe little tweaks that you can do, things you can make to, if you want to make your own version based on this pattern. And I love anything that lets me get into a designer's head, because I'm still trying to learn, you know, about design. So a feature like that, that I didn't even know was in here, like I said, I feel like I got really good value out of purchasing this book, and I've only had it for like 2 days now.
Okay. We will be linking to the book in the description bar below, and everything else we talk about, it will be linked in our description bar.
So those are just some of the things that are prancing in my head like visions of sugar plums.
And that's a crocheter raving about a knit book. Okay.
I know, right? But we don't get the same kind of looks. I'm not gonna do it again.
Okay.
But be nice if it was a crochet analog of that. Anyway, what else are you working on? Really?
that's all I'm working on at the moment. But now I'm kind of obsessed with this pattern, with the stitch pattern, so I might make a pair of socks with it.
Other things I'm thinking about. Child. Sometimes it feels like my head is actually swelling with all the stuff I'm trying to keep together. I'm trying to get better about writing things down so that at least it's not just in my head. I don't feel like I'm trying to juggle it and keep it all in the air.
Trying to remember it all.
Exactly.
Oh, please.
But I'm also thinking about my Christmas sweater, because it's November. Okay. I feel like I've been saying the words Christmas sweater for a while, but I've taken no action towards the creation of a Christmas sweater. And I'm like, if I actually want this by Christmas, and I don't want to have to hurry and do one starting the week before Christmas that I actually finish on Christmas Day like I did last year, I might want to get a start on this year's Christmas sweater. And I have my yarn chosen, is the thing. So the yarn is from Cozy Colorworks. And I think they're local. They're like New Jersey or Pennsylvania.
I think so, yeah.
So I actually bought these two a few years ago at Allentown Fiber Festival, which is no more. And I didn't know if these two would be enough to make a top by themselves. They're actually each 550 yards, so got a little bit extra yarn there. So this year at Jersey Sheep and Wool, I bought one more color. But see how the red one has those little flecks of green in it? And so I feel like, that pops. That looks good. Yes. Oh my gosh. But, you know, inflation at work, right? Because when I bought these, this was $29 a few years ago. this bad boy was 32. So it's basically gone up $1 a year. So be it. But so between these two, I have over 1,650 yards. So definitely enough to make a long sleeve sweater, except I have no clue what I want to do. But I like the, I feel like it's Christmassy without being too on the nose.
Oh yeah.
So like you could just, you could wear it other times and people won't be like, is she wearing her Christmas sweater in April? But I don't know what I'm going to do. So I need to, I'm going to have to look at some sweater inspiration online and see what I can come up with. Because right now I'm clueless.
So not even like body plan, nothing?
Nothing.
Gotcha.
Yeah. It's very frustrating. I'm just like, I know I want to make a sweater. I know what yarn I want to use. And I'm drawing a blank. The Christmas sweater is always hard for me just because usually an idea, I make things as ideas come to me. Whereas Christmas sweater, there's no idea first. It's just basically a timeline. I'm trying to make a sweater, you know, that I'm going to wear on Christmas Day. And that's all I got.
Okay. I can't wait to see what you come up with. I'm sure it's going to be spectacular.
I wouldn't say spectacular. It'll be, you know, functional.
I think it's going to be awesome.
But we'll see. I know.
You got this. You got this. I see. Now I'm all, I'm like, I want to ask you like 10,000 questions. So you want to do some color work? You want to do this? That's why I'm in my head.
I'm thinking about mosaic. But I mean, I have a mosaic book that I bought recently. And maybe I'll just take a design out of there. I don't know.
And I don't see you being the type of person that would wear a literal Christmas sweater, although you do have that entire elf outfit. So maybe you are that girl.
I do have an elf outfit. I feel like no one appreciates it as much as I do, but
I like it. You don't know me. I like
it. It's basically just like a long tunic style sweater that looks like a little elf outfit, and I may have some striped socks. We're not going to talk about it, but yeah.
So you could go either way.
But we'll see. We'll see.
Depending on timeline, this might end up being my Christmas sweater.
That's, you see all that stuff I had in my head? I have the new book and the patterns in it and the cross top and whether or not I have enough yarn and figuring out the Christmas sweater and revamping the Linus Shrug. And oh my God, I feel like I need to lie down.
Oh, it's going to be fine. It's going to be fine. Whew. Okay. You gave me a little anxiety.
Right? That's how I feel. I'm just like, oh my God.
No. That's where we at, y'all. I have some possibilities for my Queen Latifah shrug. One, I'm not really excited about doing, but if the yarn works out, I'll probably do it.
Hair?
No, it'll be in a fingering way.
I don't understand your thing.
Because you know what? I have this beautiful fingering weight yarn that I had slated a project for it, but I abandoned that project a while ago, so I might just reclaim that yarn. But if that yarn doesn't work, and I think it might actually be too flimsy, I have an idea to do a combination of Barocco chai and mohair held together.
Also, kind of happy.
Actually, no, Barocco chai knits up very light. I can show you my project I did out of it, and the mohair makes it even lighter, but it's going to drape because linen and silk drape.
Okay,
it's gonna have the drape and it's gonna have the fuzziness that her version has because of the mohair.
I'll have to see swatches.
I ain't scared of a swatch.
And she had a thing with finger and weight yarn. I don't know. She'll only make socks with it.
I like making socks with finger and weight yarn.
Right, but you know, I think finger-weight sweaters look really good.
They're cute. Yes, they are. I just feel like they'll take eons.
Well, you can use a slightly larger needle size. I feel like, I don't know, using a bigger needle size with a lighter yarn works better than using a bigger hook with a lighter yarn, because with crochet, you get holes. You're going to get a hole the size of your hook.
That's the thing, you know, if you go up too big with fingering weight, you get the same effect. You get holes. Or your fabric is like super see-through.
Yeah. But I think you can, you know, you can use a slightly bigger needle and move it along a little faster. But you know what? It takes as long as it takes. I mean, you spent 6 months doing your colorwork sweater last year.
I did, but I wasn't constantly knitting.
And
it
wasn't.
I took a lot of breaks.
So I'm just saying, you know, you can take breaks and still finish your sweater. I feel like you have like a anti-fingering weight prejudice.
I don't feel like it's a prejudice.
What's that
I feel
about?
Like it's more of a
We're saying, sounds like a prejudice to me.
All right, let me ask you guys. Do you make fingering weight sweaters? I have not. I usually, if I'm doing a sweater for myself, I do DK or worsted. And I'm actually quite happy at that weight.
I feel like you should try it once.
That's what they say about skydiving.
I don't think anyone says that about skydiving.
No, what?
Like skydiving is like kind of a lifestyle choice.
For a tiny minority of people, they only try it that one time. Yeah, the patterns in that book are this really kind of cool.
This is gorgeous, and I feel like I could do something like that. That's rectangles, baby.
Oh, God, this is right up your alley.
If it's just rectangles, like, dial me in.
What? Now, you know, it's so funny because what you said about Nora Gone working out her patterns in paper and fabric, I was thinking about working out the sleeves for this jacket in tissue paper because I wasn't sure if I liked the width of the sleeve, and I thought I would just mock up the jacket in tissue paper and try it out that way. You see what I mean? You see, they're kind of wide.
You want, but the body is wide too.
Yeah, I didn't think I would like cut it in half, but I thought I'd go a little bit narrower.
Yeah, you can.
Ooh, that was cute. And Crystal just got distracted.
I did, because you know what? I haven't seen this, and I'm just like.
And that's exactly how we were.
These are really like. They're rectangles, so things are very simple. What is it called?
Knit kimono.
By somebody square?
Yeah.
Vicky square. No, like I can make a rectangle. I got rectangles down.
Oh, yes.
Interesting.
So we will also put a link to this book in the description bar. And while Crystal's distracted with the knit kimono.
Now, here I am. Hi.
I was like, she is not sitting there reading this book.
Not reading, perusing, glancing.
I did want to share with you guys some announcements. I am going to be teaching at Vogue Knitting in February, doing two classes, Bind Off Loosely Like a Pearl and How to Work a Pattern. Do check it out. I'm going to include a link down below in the description box. If you're going to be in New York City, come see me. Also, we are starting starting a class online called The Maker Studio. I will also be putting links in the description bar below to that. And that is the sort of class where you learn to do what we do here. How to make things your way with your yarn. If you want to change it, show you how to change things, how to regauge so that you can make what you like with your yarn, unless it's completely wrong for it, and then and everybody tells you and you don't listen and you swatch it anyway, and then you discover it'll be perfect
for something else.
But do check out the links below. And that's what we're up to in terms of classes. Yay.
Can we talk about something?
Sure.
Are y'all wearing the stuff y'all make? I feel like this comes up a lot. And I am finding that a lot of people don't wear the stuff they make. And I'm like, well, then why are you making it? I know like there's the gift giver contingent, right? There are the people who just make things for other people. And I get that, you know, crocheting, knitting, they're hobbies, right? So you're not doing them on a deadline. You're not doing them, you know, with any kind of expectations, you just you enjoy doing that thing. But I also, on the flip side of that, I hear so many people complaining about the cost, right? The cost of yarn and the cost of patterns and, you know, how much money they're spending on this hobby. Mm-hmm. I feel like the way you recoup that is by wearing what you made. But a lot of people aren't. And I feel like maybe that's why it seems very expensive to you, because you're not actually getting like a sweater that you're going to wear to work or whatever out of it. Are y'all wearing what you make? This confuses me. Because I started crocheting scarves, right? Like when I was just learning like how to read patterns, I was using a stitch dictionary to learn how to read patterns. And then eventually I was like, wait a minute, people make clothes with crochet. I don't have any crochet clothes. Why is that? And I decided I would try to make garments. But and my first one came out all kinds of wonky. It's fine. But it just motivated me to like keep trying to make garments, always with the intention of wearing them. And for me, a successful project was one that ended in something that I felt fit to be seen in. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, some things they don't turn out that well.
And yeah, no.
You can't really wear it among people. But if you're not wearing the things you make, but you're still making like these intricate colorwork sweaters and stuff, what are you doing with them? Where do they go? Where do they live? What are we wearing what we make? Is that like as motivating for other people as it is for me? Because I don't know. I can only see it one way. I can only see the purpose of doing this to make things for myself to wear. So I'm really curious about these other perspectives and these people I keep hearing say they don't. And so like I've seen conversations online where mm-hmm. people talk about making a lot of things that they don't like because, you know, the pattern is popular or the yarn is popular or what have you. And so they end up with all of these like a stack of projects, but none of them are things that they would wear, but they made them anyway. And that's a lot of money and that's a lot of time. And yeah. I don't care how much you like the act of knitting or the act of crocheting. At some point, I don't know that you're getting back out of it what you're putting into it.
I'm kind of with you because I couldn't imagine just making something to put it away in a stack. So generally, okay, let me put it this way. Sometimes I have made things because I wanted to learn a technique, mm-hmm. but I always had a plan for that technique. You know what I mean? I might make a small thing because it had a technique I was interested in learning. But then I would apply that to something else that
but
I would actually
use. But then you
make
like a whole sweater that you never intend to wear because you want to learn a technique?
No, I would want to.
Or
I would have to want to wear that sweater.
Like people just make blankets and blankets and blankets. And then you just have a stack of blankets.
Yeah, I would need to, you know, do something more about that. And I get such a thrill out of wearing the things I make. That even when I was just making ugly hats, I wore those ugly hats.
She wore ugly hats. She was very excited about
it. And they were fugly. Okay.
Just those first few. They really, like you could see improvement. You really could. You could.
But I don't understand really why people would make, you know, a ginormous, super colorful shawl with really expensive yarn when they don't wear that sort of
thing. Like, okay, so Stephen West, you know, just had his make-along, his Bisnu make-along. I wasn't crazy about this particular shawl, and it was interesting watching. If he has a YouTube channel, and he did a video for each clue. There were four mm-hmm. clues, and he did a tutorial video for each clue, and more than once he'd said, oh, I just learned how to do this technique. And so it felt like he was just throwing in all of these things that he just learned because he was excited about learning them. But for me, the shawl didn't kind of come together. It was more like a stitch sampler.
Yeah. I saw the finished shawl and I was like, oh, I don't know about this one. But I thought, well, maybe it's going to come together at the end. But it didn't for me. Mm-mm.
So are you... are you gonna wear it? I guess that's what I'm getting at. Like, I maybe people who have made it like it better than I like it. Mm-hmm. That's fine. I've seen some shawls by Stephen West that I think are really, really beautiful. He has this shawl called Canal Rings that I am absolutely in love with. But this one just wasn't for me. And last year's wasn't for me either. Yeah. If you don't like it, do you wear it anyway? Or at some point, do you stop and say, I don't like how this shawl is going? Or do you wait to see that do you wait for it to be finished before you continue so you can decide if you want to put the time into it? Mm-hmm. Like, are some people just making the shawl because it's a Stephen West make along? Even though you don't plan to wear it, because maybe you don't actually wear shawls.
Yeah, that's another thing. Have you made things that you know? Well, if you are a garment maker, if you make things that people wear, have you made things that are wearable that you knew you weren't going to wear when you were making them?
Yeah, that's do you know ahead of time? I don't wear shawls. Because I seen the prices of these kits he was selling. I wouldn't spend that kind of money and, like I said, not get that back by wearing it.
And to be honest, he just announced his...
The hibernating?
The hibernating.
Yeah.
And
that one's better.
I like the shawl for the hibernating.
That one's much better. Way better.
And some of his... I'm a Stephen West fan. I've been following his career for a long time. And I like his shawls, but... I'm the person who would wear a colorful shawl full of different colors and different textures. I mean, Crystal has looked at my laundry hanging up and going, well, dang, don't you wear anything that's a solid color? So that is my style. So I would be very cheerful wearing one of those shawls. But...
And they're big.
I'm a big person, so yeah, that would work for me. That would work for me. And for Stephen West, because he's a 6-footer of a man. He's a big man. But I always wonder about petite women who are making these ginormous shawls. Are you wearing them? And if so, how?
Not everything can be one bib style, ladies and gentlemen. Not everything works like that.
So I'm just like, I have wondered about that myself. Because... if you're buying his kits, they're not inexpensive at all. The shawls have been getting progressively bigger as time goes on, at least in terms of number of skeins. Because I think the last one was it 5?
It's 5. Hybrid knitting is also 5.
Yeah.
It's 5 different colors for the make-along hats. And there's like 2 2-on-1. So I guess my question is, if you are making things that you don't intend to wear, like you already know ahead of time, what is your enjoyment in the making? What are you getting out of it? Because I literally just don't understand. It's mm-hmm. such a foreign concept for me. So I'm just trying to like gain some other perspectives. And do you feel like the fact that you don't wear the things you make affects your view of the prices of yarn and patterns? Like, this is a concern for me because I'm spending so much money on things that I don't wear. Y'all let me know because I am super curious.
Me too. I am curious about that.
I think for me, I'm just like, I get such a kick out of the idea of making, for me, making clothes is like an old timey thing. It's a thing we don't have to do anymore, right? Because you can go to the store and buy any old garment. Think about the fact that you used to have to know a leather tanner to get something made out of leather, right? And now you can just go to the mall, right? And buy a leather jacket or leather boots or what have you.
And never see a cow. Mm-hmm.
Never smell a cow. But I get a kick out of the fact that I'm doing like this like way old timey thing. Like I'm a thoroughly modern Millie, but I can do, it's like this neat trick I can do, right? Like I can make a shirt. What? So I that's what's exciting to me, mm-hmm. that like some I if I wasn't crocheting, it would never even occur to me to try to make clothes. This is just the method that I'm using, mm-hmm. to obtain clothes without buying them at a store. So this not wearing the stuff you make is just like, but then what do you do? I literally just don't get it. So I'm just trying to understand. Because, I mean, this kind of goes back to the conversation I saw online, people talking about the fact that they actually hate crochet.
Yeah.
But they do it anyway. And so I'm just like, you don't wear the stuff and you hate doing it. What's going on out there? So I'm trying to understand like where people are coming from. Like my purpose is my why is making clothes. What's your why for knitting or crocheting? Yeah, that's what I want to know. What's your why?
Yeah, what's your why? I like that.
Yes. Do share.
Okay.
Yeah, that was just on my mind.
Yeah. All right, girl. I think that's it for me today, though.
Yeah.
How about you?
I'm good.
So on that note, thank you guys for coming and spending this time with us. Let us know what your why is in the comments. All right? Have a good week, everybody.
Stay stitching.